Welcome to another installment of Future of Blockchain. I'm here with Gary Gensler of MIT. Thanks for being here.
Good to be with you, Richard.
So tell me a little bit about how you made your way into the wild world of crypto.
I'm really here by happenstance. I've lived a lifetime around finance and public policy, being on Wall Street for early part of my career, and then finding my way into serving in both President Clinton's and President Obama's administrations. But it was really a faculty member here at MIT, Simon Johnson, who knew me a little bit from my work at something called the Commodity Futures Trading Commission, which I had been so honored to chair.
Heard of it, yeah.
Post the financial crisis, where we were trying to bring a very significant market, a $300 or $400 trillion market, into transparency and lowering some risk for the public. In any event, Simon Johnson approached me in 2017, who's a professor here, and said, would I be interested in coming up to MIT? I thought he meant like for a day or two to guest lecture. He had some other ideas in mind, and
got you a desk and settled in.
But no, he and Joey Ito runs the Media Lab here. Both wanted me to come and get involved in the Media Lab, specifically with regard to the digital currency initiative here at the Media Lab. Get involved in some other projects around the ethics and governance of artificial intelligence.
Okay.
And I said that would be terrific if I can also teach. I had taught when I was a 22-year-old and a 21-year-old, and I wanted to get back to teaching a little bit. And so I became affiliated with the Sloan School and the Media Lab and was off to the races.
That's great. And so you look at the next year for your work at MIT, and what are you hoping to accomplish?
Well, I like bringing together a number of aspects. One, the classroom with research, and we've stood up now this year successfully four different student offerings in the blockchain technology and crypto space, something that focused more on the business of blockchain called Blockchain and Money, a course on crypto finance, where students really are going to get their hands into valuing some of these topics. Good luck, yeah. And a couple other course offerings, four different course offerings. So I find really rewarding. But also talking to entrepreneurs, talking to other academics, talking to technologists, and even talking to regulators, and sort of bringing those four legs of this kind of the stool together, the markets, the technology, the law, the social norms, as Larry Lessig says, kind of the four norms that help a market. And so in the next year for me, of course, it's a little bit more of the same, obviously bringing more students' engagement into this. But centered on my research is really trying to figure out where there is with regard to blockchain technology.
So you found it?
Well, I'm still looking, Richard. Okay. I'm still looking. I'm neither a minimalist nor a maximalist, but I think there's an awful lot of hype that's masquerading as fact. And center to this, and it's a little wonky or geeky, but center to this is blockchain technology, this kind of innovation that we ascribe to Satoshi Nakamoto and Bitcoin, is a database structure that is more tamper resistant than other database structures, meaning it's harder to mess with it, but it comes with a cost. And secondly, it's this concept that you don't have a central authority or central intermediary. But naturally, the question is do you really need the append-only log and the cost of doing these blocks? A blockchain is just a block and a block and a block and something cryptographically putting it together. And most importantly, do you need consensus among multiple parties? And this interesting other question that sort of floats around it in finance is, do you need a native token? Do you need a new currency? And so that's the body of what I research, I talk about, I sort of explore, and I look forward to doing more in the next year.
Oh, that's great. And so have you come to any conclusions on what you think is like, okay, that is a really good use case?
Look, there's a number of things. When the internet came along in the 1990s, people would say, well, what was the killer app that kept it along? And And there's, of course, now we use it for everything in our life that gets information. Mm-hmm. And we make payments and things. But initially, it was email.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So you're asking me, have I found anything? Right now, the kind of killer apps, literally, have been, it's been crowdsourcing. $25 or $30 billion has been raised.
Raise money outside and, of traditional VC.
And you're a venture capitalist, you're a traditional venture capitalist. So this is a more permissionless, cross-border way to raise money. I think a lot of it is non-compliant with U.S. and other securities laws. I think it's rife with scams and fraud. If we could tame that down and kind of get it into some investor protection paradigm, which I think is relevant, it's still kind of an interesting way to raise money. Second use case has been pure speculation. Okay, call it what it is, but Bitcoin itself,
it's
a speculation. It is a store of value at that. And for some, that gives them a diversification. It's not highly correlated with other asset classes, so. I think those have kind of been the killer apps so far.
Yeah.
Now the question is, can you take it and go somewhere else? Could it change the world of payments? I think this school's still out on that.
Yeah.
I think we're multiple years away from it being scalable and the performance criteria, but I wouldn't count it out. I think within, you know, call it 5 and it might be 10 years, this will perform a great deal better. And a lot of that's being discussed at this conference that I'm at this weekend, the Bitcoin Expo.
Yeah, great. So with that, I'd actually love to dive into some rapid fire questions if you're ready.
All right.
What do you think the top factors?
And you're not going to ask me about like my daughters or my girlfriend.
I won't. No.
Okay.
No.
All right.
Unless you want me to.
Well, no. They're all doing great. They're all doing great.
Cool. So, top factors hindering blockchain adoption.
Use cases. The viability of use cases. Top factor.
When it comes to that, when it comes to these use cases, a lot of it's been around speculation.
And crowdfunding.
So,
which is tapped into the speculation.
Yeah, on the crowdfunding basis, do you think the ICO's dead? It's there was a real boom.
I think that the way to pre-fund a development project, which is somebody that almost nobody hears of, J.R. Willett came up with this idea in 2012. And he didn't become rich on it because nobody could listen to him talk about it. He started OmniCoin eventually.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But do I think it's dead? No.
Okay.
Do I think that it's coming into a different phase? Yes. There's still about 150 to 200 projects a month. And in the last few months, they've been still raising $300 to $500 million a month collectively. But I think that 90%+, maybe 99% will go the way of the dodo bird? Yes, though I have more respect for the dodo bird than some of these projects. That dodo bird survived for thousands of years.
Yeah, it's a pretty resilient
bird. Pretty resilient bird until the Europeans got to that small island. The fundamental question will still be, is there a real use case, not only for this append-only logs and consensus protocols, but is there a use case for a single-use currency?
Mm-hmm.
See, most currencies in the world, when they're successful, are multi-use. You can buy coffee, or in the old days, you could buy your grain at the market, and the person who was the farmer could take it and pay their laborers. It's multi-use.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that creates an incredible network effect around this technology called currency, because currency is but a social and technological innovation.
I
have some challenges. Do you need a single use currency?
Hmm.
Now, of course, in the gaming area, we have kind of currencies. There's called shields and skins and swords. But do we really need a single use file token?
Yeah.
Or a single-use restaurant review token.
Yeah.
So that's a challenge.
I think it'll be interesting to see how that unfolds. I think around that aspect. Tell me a little bit about, you know, if you're an entrepreneur in this space and you're kind of looking at the regulatory landscape, do you think it's pretty clear today?
Well, first, let me just say, I successfully spent a lot of years on Wall Street and at Goldman Sachs, I'm currently not invested in any of this space. I don't advise any companies. So I've chosen to be sort of conflict-free, and I'm now here at MIT teaching and doing research. The regulatory space, as with any new technology, is looking at this technology and still trying to say, live within public policy norms and frameworks. What does that broadly mean? We don't really want illicit activity to move to this new technology. And in the US and in most countries, I think it's pretty clear the tax regimes, this is property, it's not currency. The anti-money laundering and anti-terrorist regimes, that you've got to keep track of who buys and sells this. I think it's pretty clear in that space. I think where it's less clear, if you wish, is in the investor protection space. So I think guarding against illicit activity, like you still have to pay your taxes if you buy and sell this stuff, it's property, and you really can't fund terrorists or try to promote the dark web and drug trafficking. But in investor protection, in the US, in a sense, most ICOs, initial coin offerings, are probably securities.
Clearly.
And so most of them are capital raising functions, and yet they're not necessarily complying with securities laws. The exchanges that list those securities are probably largely non-compliant with securities laws, even though they're listing securities. So I think it's going to take some time. I was hopeful that it would be a little earlier, but I think 2019, 2020, the U.S. Securities Exchange Commission, Canada, elsewhere, Europe, they're grappling with similar issues, but the laws are different in each jurisdiction.
Yeah, and it's inherently a pretty difficult thing to regulate. I mean, a thing without center is inherently hard to...
Well, see, I'm going to challenge that a little bit.
Please.
Most of this does have a center. So Satoshi Nakamoto's 8-page paper that was put out on a cypherpunk email list, that's kind of centered in a more decentralized conceptual framework and maybe a libertarian framework.
Yeah, very much so.
But by and large, the thousands of crypto tokens that have come since are highly centralized. Ethereum is centered around the Ethereum Foundation and Vitalik Buterin and a team of developers. There's 70 people that work at the Ethereum Foundation, not all of whom are developers, but, you know. And in most of these projects, away from Bitcoin and Ethereum, there's a group of 2 to 5 developers that are really highly centralized in terms of maintaining, promoting, enhancing the code and the business model of that offering. So there's conceptual framework, and then there's economic reality.
Makes sense.
And the economic reality is much more centralized protocols, ownership of the tokens, mining, of course, is somewhat centralized, and then the secondary markets.
So it brings me to a whole nother area, which is mining. Do you think mining today is centralized or decentralized?
Well, it somewhat depends on the token, but there's clusters of centralization. Though I haven't looked at the recent statistics, I think 3 or maybe just 2 mining pools represent over 50% of Bitcoin mining. Usually it's 2 or 3 mining pools that represent about half of the Ethereum. And it's 10 or 12 mining pools that represent about 95% of the mining. And amongst those top 3, I guess 2 are in China and 1's in Russia. So that's kind of an interesting observation as well.
So you're saying I put my money on stuff being mined in Russia and Asia?
That would be one way to put it. Yes. Yeah. But I mean, it's an interesting ecosystem.
So, do you think we'll have a sovereign stablecoin? So I think of this as U.S. dollar issues a cryptocurrency.
So you earlier asked me about where I think the use cases come. I think there is a gap, a very significant economic gap in our current payment systems infrastructure and our current security settlement and clearing infrastructures. And there's two gaps. They're not 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Yeah.
They just simply aren't. They could be technologically, but they're not. Central banks have not chosen to do that yet, and it might be in the 2020s they will, but we're not there. Neither are securities clearing and settlement. Secondly, they're not continuous, meaning that even when they're open, you usually, to change a ledger balance in a payment system or a ledger balance in a security system, and particularly when you have something cross ledgers, it's the end of the day, or it's 2 days later, or it's what we would call, from those of us who remember it from the 1980s, batch processing.
Yeah.
Once a day. Mm-hmm. So they're not 24/7 and they're not continuous. I think those gaps are something that private sector actors are trying to fill with stable value tokens, both in the retail space and the wholesale space. So whether it's a company here local to Boston, Circle has, along with Coinbase, they have the US dollar coin, or Paxos has one, and Gemini has one. I mean, there's a lot of private sector sort of offerings to address the retail space. There's some wholesale offerings. There's a consortium of 15 or 20 large banks that are doing it. And recently, even JP Morgan says maybe we'll get in there. I think with these private sector offerings, you raised the question, will central banks do it as well? I think it's not even a question of if, it's just when.
So when do you think that is?
A tokenized fiat currency already, in a sense, exists because we have digital fiat currency. Central banks have reserves with commercial banks. In the U.S., there's 9,000 commercial banks that can have a digital representation of money with the central bank.
Yeah.
And then you and I have digital money with banks, which is called bank deposits.
Yep.
So then the question is will the central bank offer that to the public directly? Or will they just do it in a wholesale way somehow with some smaller group of clients? The countries furthest along, like Sweden and others on this project, I think somebody will do it. It's 180 or so countries. Somebody's going to do it, but I couldn't tell you whether we're 3 years away or 8 years away.
Okay.
It's not in 2019,
yeah.
I don't think. But there's even like a test pilot that Saudi Arabia is doing with the Emirates right now.
Yeah.
And they're going to try to stand up.
And others,
well, Venezuela Petro is a little bit different because they're saying we're trying to back something with oil.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a company in extremis. There's a country that's having challenges, many of which are self-imposed, but challenges and their public doesn't really respect their currency. And whether they're the type of country, or it's going to be the strong country, the country with strong fiscal and monetary policy and a strong economy that just says this is a way to offer a better, faster, cheaper payment system.
Yeah. Okay. Final question. What's your favorite or a project that you admire and think is particularly interesting in this space?
MIT's Digital Currency Initiative. So I've
got
to come back to the home base.
Perfect.
Home base. I think what Nehat and Taj and the others have put together is great.
Yeah, they've built an incredible thing. And Gary, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.